Hello everyone, and welcome to my session, Containerize Your Java Applications Using Eclipse JKube. My name is Marc, and I work as a software engineer for Red Hat. I'm currently working on two open source projects, the Fabricate Kubernetes Client and Eclipse JKube, which I'll be presenting today. This is the agenda for today's session. I will start with an introduction. Then I will list what are the common challenges to deploying applications to Kubernetes nowadays. I will go ahead and explain what Eclipse JKube is and showcase a short demo with the features. And finally, I will tell you why you should choose Eclipse JKube instead of some other alternatives. So, well, I know that there are many different people with different backgrounds attending DevConf. So what I want to make sure is that we are all on the same page. So let's start with this slide that I think that it should look pretty familiar to most of us. And this was the traditional workflow when you wanted to deploy your standard Java applications to a server in the past, or your web applications. So basically you started with code, then you had some build process that generated an artifact, be it a fajar, a war, or something else. And then this artifact will be delivered to your operations team that would deploy it into a production server, which contain an operating system and a Java runtime environment and whatnot. So I'm pretty sure that many of the developers were not familiar with this last step and many of the tasks that were involved, because probably you had an operations team that took care of all of this. But of course, the paradigm has or is changing in the last few years, and the platform of choice is, of course, Kubernetes. And what this really means is that many of these tasks and infrastructure components are shifting to the left. So right now, you as a developer are starting to be responsible for, on top of delivering your application package, you have to deliver probably a container image, which includes not only your application package, but a container operating system, a Java runtime environment, and so on. And you are now responsible for creating these images, the configurations, etc. So yeah, as we've seen, one of the challenges right now for Java developers is that you will need to deliver both a container image and also cluster configurations. So the classic approach to create a container image is, of course, using Docker. And well, for Docker, the classic approach is to create a Docker file. So this is a very simple Docker file, which basically starts with an OpenJDK base image. Then it adds your application package, and then it provides an entry point that will run your application whenever the container image is deployed. So on top of the standard Maven package, you now need to or depend on the Docker CLI to build your image and also to push it to a shared registry that would be accessible from the cluster. So of course, this image seems quite simple, but I know and I'm sure that with time, this image will grow and will change and things will start to get more and more complex. And for the cluster, it's something similar, but instead of using Docker, you need to know about YAML. So you will probably need to provide a few YAML files to be able to deploy your application, usually at least a deployment and a service, and most probably a config map and an ingress. So you will need to create YAML files and configurations for these resources. And of course, you will also need a way to deploy these resources into your cluster. So you will probably depend on kubectl or some other tool like Helm. Again, an external dependency. So as we've seen right now, all of these responsibilities that previously were or belonged to an operations team, they are now, they fall on you, and you will be responsible to keeping these configuration files updated and also aligned. So if you change something in your Docker file or in your Docker build, you will also probably need to change something in your Kubernetes resource and so on. So of course, these configurations will grow and will become more and more complex. And I think that having to deal with this yourself is really painful and will eventually end up in some bugs or issues in production, and that's not something that we want. So this is where JKube comes in handy, because it's a tool that will cover the complete workflow. So it will create your container images and also your cluster configuration. And probably you will not even need to add any specific configuration. So let's go ahead and see what Eclipse JKube is. It's a set of tools and plugins that will help you generate the container images and also generate the configuration manifests and deploy them to your cluster. So the project consists of three components: the standalone Java API, which we call Kit, and two Maven plugins, as of now, that use this API. So the Kubernetes Maven plugin will be used to create container images and deploy them to a vanilla Kubernetes cluster. And the OpenShift Maven plugin is built on top of the Kubernetes plugin and will provide more OpenShift specific features, such as S2I build strategy or more OpenShift specific resource configurations. Regarding build strategies, I don't want to go very deep on this. I'm just going to tell you that JKube can provide a Docker, an S2I, or a JIT build strategy. But what I'm going to tell you is that you can easily change from one build strategy to the other just by switching a configuration flag. So that's something very powerful that JKube offers you. The plugin can be configured in three modes. So the first and easiest is the zero configuration. This means that JKube will make use of its opinionated defaults and support for many multiple frameworks and technologies, and will create the container image and cluster configurations without providing any kind of configuration. Of course, we all know that our application is special and has some specifics, so there is an easy way to improve these defaults or to override them by using the XML plugin configuration. Even if this is not enough, we also offer these resource fragments, which basically is the option for you to provide partial YAML configurations that JKube will pick up and enrich with its opinionated defaults. So basically what I'm telling you is that you can go ahead and throw all of those configuration files into the trash and add this simple plugin to your Maven configuration, and everything will be automatically integrated into your Maven workflow process. So just by invoking our specific goals, your project will be ready to be deployed into the cluster. But I'm sure that it's better to see this in action, so let me show you this in a very quick demonstration. Okay, so for today's demo, I chose the Spring Boot admin application, which is a very, very popular project. And well, it's basically an admin user interface to administer your Spring Boot applications. And I think it can be quite impressive to see how we can deploy this on a Kubernetes cluster. So this is the project in my IDE. It's the main branch, but I created a different branch to include the manual configurations to be able to deploy the project to the cluster and show them to you. But it's just the unmodified project, okay? This is important to highlight. So basically, as we saw, the usual approach to deploy an application to Kubernetes was to create a Docker file along with your project. Again, this is a very simple project, so basically this is the simplest Docker file I could create. It's just basically the base image using a Java runtime environment and copying the artifact and the entry point, okay? Of course, along with the Docker file, you will have to provide some commands to be able to build your image and to push it to your shared registry. So in this case, I created this script, and finally, this is the cluster configuration. Again, this is the simplest configuration I could create to deploy this application. In my case, I'm going to deploy this to my Minikube cluster. So I just created a service with a node port in order to avoid the creation of an ingress and to simplify things, and a deployment. Again, the simplest deployment I could create. No liveness probes, no nothing. And it's also important to highlight that this image name and tag should align with the one that we are tagging in Docker. So you should keep in mind that when you are providing different configurations and using different systems, you are responsible to keeping things aligned. And again, many errors can start happening due to these things. Okay, so I could go ahead and show you how to deploy this in my cluster, but I mean, there is not that much time. And I will go ahead and start doing the same, but with JKube. So the first step when we are going to use JKube is delete all of this nonsense, get rid of these configurations, because JKube will provide everything for us. And thing is going to be as simple as adding our plugin. Okay. And since we want to modify a little bit the configuration, because as I said, I want to create an outboard instead of just to create an equivalent configuration. So I'm just going to fine tune the service and create an outboard. And also, since I want to publish this into my Docker Hub account, I need to provide a specific name for my image. So I'm going to use this one. All right. Let's make it like this. Okay. So that's it. The next step, just perform the standard build, like maven clean package as usual. Okay, the build finished. And now is the time to see JKube in action. So the first thing I'm going to do is build the image. It's as simple as maven khs build. This will basically analyze the project, see what base image is appropriate for. Something wrong happened here. Okay, as I was saying, this will basically analyze our project, check which is the base image that we are going to need, and we'll create an image for you. We'll analyze if Docker is present in our system and use Docker or use something else, depending again on our environment. So the image has already been created for us. If we check the images available, we saw that this image was just created again with the tag that we specified. And now we want to push it to our Docker Hub account in order to make it available for the cluster. So again, as simple as invoking a push goal provided by JKube. And okay, the push is starting. You can see it's choosing the name I selected before. And okay, push completed. Okay, so it completed successfully. And now the image should be available in my Docker Hub account. Okay, so far so good. The part for creating the container image is complete. We just added, as you saw, the plugin, and basically I configured the tag for the image, but that's it. Nothing else was done. No Docker file required. The next step, I'm going to create the cluster configuration. So for that, we are going to use this KHS resource goal. Okay, and now once it completes, okay, so this is not necessary for us to check, but just to compare with what we had before, this is what JKube generated for us. So as you can see, the configuration is much more thorough than the one that we provided manually. It has labels, it has lots of stuff, it even has support for Prometheus. And also it's important to know that the JKube detected that this was a Spring Boot project and that it has the actuator. So it added a readiness and a liveness probe for us. So again, stuff that we didn't even consider when we were creating our manual configurations has been created for us out of the box. Nothing to configure, nothing to, I mean, the only thing we configured was the type of the service port. So yeah, effectively this is a node port. So basically now we can apply this to our cluster. So this is the my dashboard of the cluster. So whenever we hit the apply, our apply goal, the JKube apply goal will run, and we will take these resources we generated and apply them to the cluster. Okay, so as you can see, the resources were applied successfully. It created a service, it created a deployment, and of course the deployment automatically created the replica set and the pod. So okay, it's not marked as ready because we created this liveness and readiness probe. So until the container is ready and this probe's passed, it will be marked already. But let me use the time to show you some other tool that you will get out of the box with JKube. So for example, we can review the logs. So if everything works, yeah, okay. This is actually showing the logs live from our application. And if everything worked okay, I would be able to access the, yeah. So user, password, this is the default credentials. Yeah. So, okay. It seems that the application is working and it was deployed okay. We can also see the log down here. So, so far, so good. Okay, but well, we saw that we had the option. I mean, right now we created everything configurationless, but let's say that we were using the manual approach and now you wanted to debug your application in the cluster. So probably you would be lost already. You would say, hey, how am I going to achieve this? Again, this is another feature that JKube offers and that it's quite useful for developers. So just by invoking this KHS debug goal, the application will restart in debug mode, hopefully, and we will be able to debug our application running in the cluster from our IDE. Okay, so right now we see that the application is restarted in, again, since we have these readiness probes, it takes longer for things to work. Okay, so it's ready. Now we can create, okay, we already have the configuration, but I'm going to recreate it for you so you can see it from the start. I can create a debug configuration, remote debug. So let's call it debug. Okay, and we even provide the instructions for you to add here, but okay, this is the default, so we can start the debug session. And okay, it's connected, perfect. And I'm going to add a breakpoint into the into this custom endpoint, something that it's showed in the in this Spring Boot admin example. So if I go ahead and try to retrieve that endpoint, the IDE execution should stop and I should be able to debug stuff. So, okay, you can go here and yeah. So let me change this value. And yeah, so I intercepted the call and I was able to replace the value on my ID. Again, I can hit this. So yeah, you could do like a standard debug session if things didn't work okay. Again, you are debugging directly from the cluster. So it's really cool and useful, okay? Okay, and let me stop the session. So finally, another of the tools that JKube offers out of the box is to clean up resources. So if we hit the undeploy goal, we will be able to remove everything from the cluster. Okay, so do this, and eventually all of the resources that were created should be deleted. Yeah, as you can see, everything is deleted. Okay, so we went already from this manual configuration with Docker files and YAML files and so on to just adding plugin and these properties. But what if I told you that I could just do this and with the vanilla project be able to deploy this into OpenShift? So since OpenShift offers additional features, it's even possible to deploy this simple application. Of course, we are taking advantage of the simplicity to deploy this application. So let me log in into my sandbox cluster. For instance, you can get these clusters for free because Red Hat is offering this for developers. So this is what I did. And okay, let me go ahead and take advantage of JKube without even adding the dependency. So this is really, really cool. Okay, I'm going to go and build the application. So, okay, it detected the OpenShift cluster and a build just started in my cluster. It's using S2I again, since it detected the OpenShift cluster, it's using OpenShift specific features. In this case, S2I build. You can see the build progress in the log, and we could also see this if we entered here in the. Okay, this log should show exactly the same that we are seeing here. Okay. Okay, so the build completed successfully. And now we should be able to deploy this application. Okay. Again, nothing added to my project. It's out of the box. Okay. So we should be able to see the application in the topology section of our console. Yeah, here it is. Okay, so, well, since again, we have this actuator and this liveness probe, it will take a while to make it ready, but in the meantime, we can check the logs from the cluster. Okay, it appears to be ready, but let's see what the log shows. Running ready. Okay, so if we open this URL, yeah, the application was just deployed to our cluster. So, and it's working just like before. So this is really, really, really cool. Again, we can use the undeploy call and our cluster would be clean. See? Yeah, so everything is clean now. Okay, so we now saw many of the features that JKube offer us. So let's see why should I choose Eclipse JKube instead of some other alternative? Well, so as we saw, the main advantage of JKube instead of other alternatives is that it covers the complete workflow. So it creates your container images, but it will also create your cluster configuration and deploy them to your cluster. So there is no need to use several tools, just one tool for everything. It's also important to note that there are no external dependencies on any kind of CLI tool, so you will not need to download anything. Just add your plugin in your POM or something like that, and it will work out of the box. No need to install any kind of binary. It's also important to note that this is the Java way, so if you are developing a Java application, it's as simple as adding a Maven plugin to your build, or in the future, the Gradle plugin, which is almost ready. And yeah, other alternatives just work for or try to provide a solution for every language available. But again, you will need to install a CLI, provide specific configurations and things like that. But this is really, really just Java. Another of the advantages is the zero configuration. So we have a strong set of opinionated defaults for most of the Java frameworks or most popular Java frameworks available. So chances are that most of the things work out of the box for you. So you won't need to provide any specific configurations. As you could see, we were able to deploy a very popular application to OpenShift without anything, not even adding the plugin to our POM. So that's pretty, pretty cool and powerful stuff. And Finally, well, we offer also some additional tools for developers. So we have this debug, watch, and log goals, amongst others, that will help you deal with your application in the plugin. So in the cluster. So that's really, I think that these are really strong strong reasons for you to choose JKube instead of any other alternatives, or at least to try it out. Okay. So thank you very much for joining my session. I would really like for you to provide some feedback and to try out the project. So you can find us on Twitter, also on Gitter, and well, many places. So just visit our homepage and you will find many different ways to contribute and to get in touch with the team. And now let's, in the next QA session, let's see what questions you have. Thank you very much for joining. See you.